Thank you, Frank. As I said last week, we're going to do our ninth category in our series today, and it's a pretty cool category. It is called Forbidden Sexual Relations. Just the title's cool. As you can see, there are 25 laws that God made to go along with this category. But we're going to do things a little bit differently. Up to now, what we've been doing is we've been looking at the law, and then we've been looking at the scripture that the law came from. But we're not going to do so much of that today, because this particular category is just jam-packed, mostly full of thou shalt nots that are pretty easy to understand. So we're not going to go over each and every one of the scriptures, but they will be listed. They're listed on the back of your bulletin, each and every one of these laws is. So take them home and you can look at them there. But anyway, we're also going to move things around a little bit, because there's three words in this category that are kind of repetitive that I want to make sure that we understand what they mean. And they are, the first word is incest. And that means to have sexual relations between somebody that's closely related to you. The second one is sodomy, and that means anal sex with someone. And the third one is cardinal, and that simply means to do something that would indicate a sensual passion. Now, the very first law that God gives us in this particular category is the only law that kind of is an overview. But it's kind of a cool overview, so we'll look at it. Its number one law is not to indulge in familiarities with relatives, such as sensual kissing, cardinal embracing, or provocative winking, which may lead to incest. That's where, if you're wondering where this came from, that's a provocative wink. You know, I don't remember much about my childhood, but if I think really hard, I seem to kind of remember that winking was still around back when I was a kid. I don't know if that's still around today or not, so maybe it doesn't apply. But anyway, that's the number one law, and as we go through these, we're going to clump them together now. We're going to put them into so-called subcategories. And as we do that, you'll see that they're not exactly, I mean, they'll be in order, but you'll see numbers that are missing. You'll catch on to this really quick. So anyway, our number two law is not to commit incest with one's mother. Now, I'll tell you that all three of my oldest grandchildren in Michigan are of the age that when mom and dad are outside of the house and they catch them kissing, they give it this thing, gross. So, you know, being a good grandfather, I just indulge that as much as I can and play on that. But anyway, as we go through these things, you'll have to forgive me if at times I just simply involuntarily go, kind of like the first one. Don't have sex with your mother. Okay, number four is not to commit incest with one's father's wife. Now, you see where I put mother in parentheses? God is very, very, very specific here when he describes these relationships. So I did the work for you of sitting down and interpreting each and every one of these. Now, I suppose in a yours, mine, and our situation, or a divorce situation, that my answer might not be exactly right. And maybe that's why God was specific. But anyway, in general terms, the relationship with the question mark by it is the common terminology, or would be the common terminology. Number 5, not to commit incest with one's sister. Number 6, not to commit incest with one's father's wife's daughter. That would be my sister. Number 7, not to commit incest with one's son's daughter. That would be my granddaughter. And I got to tell you, as I'm writing this, as I'm typing this, I'm thinking to myself, you know, this might be where I would revert back to the Big Ten laws, where it says something along the lines of, do not kill. But anyway, because that might happen if never mind. Number 8, not to commit incest with one's daughter's daughter. That would be my granddaughter. Number 9 is an interesting law. Not to commit incest with one's daughter. This is not explicitly in the Torah, but it is inferred from other explicit commands that would include it. Now, what's really interesting about this is you'll find this in the Bible, you know, 3, 4, 5 times. And it's designed to make you think. God doesn't make mistakes. God doesn't make typos. Certainly, we're not here to believe that God thinks it's okay that a man have sex with his daughter. But the question becomes then, why did God leave it out of the Bible? So I'm just giving you that as food for thought, something that you can contemplate on, something that you can meditate about. But it happens 4 or 5 times in the Bible, and it's really an interesting thing to meditate. Number 10, not to commit incest with one's father's sister. That would be my aunt. I will tell you that, well, there might be a case further down that where we get into maybe a second aunt, but this is as far outside of the family dynamics as God generally goes, is the aunt. Not to commit incest with one's mother's sister. That would be my aunt. Not to commit incest with one's father's brother's wife. That would be my aunt. 14, not to commit incest with one's son's wife. That would be my daughter-in-law. 15, not to commit incest with one's brother's wife. That would be my sister-in-law. 16, not to commit incest with one's wife's daughter. That would be my daughter. Not to commit incest with the daughter of one's wife's son. That again would be my granddaughter. Not to commit incest with the daughter of one's wife's daughter. That would be my granddaughter. And number 19, not to commit incest with one's wife's sister. That would be my sister-in-law. God is very... I have no idea, unless he's thinking about the yours, mine, and ours families, or he's thinking about divorce situations, or whatever. I don't know what he was thinking about, but he was very specific in his laws and in his descriptions. The next 3 laws are God talks about sodomy. Number 3, not to commit sodomy with one's father. No, I'm not going there. I'll just finish this. Number 13, not to commit sodomy with one's father's brother. That would be my uncle. But now here is something really cool. It's as if God is listing all these people that are in, all these males that are in the family unit, and then finally he just throws up his hands and he says, I'm just going to get to the point, not to commit sodomy with a male. Why God did that, I have no idea, but it's really cool, I think, because I see that. I see him, you know, just throwing up his hands and say, hey, just don't do it. Don't commit sodomy with any male. Simple as that. It certainly should put to rest any question in God's of God's opinion on this matter. The next law is much more theologically difficult to understand, but I'm going to go through it slowly so that maybe we can pick up something. It's number 20, and it says not to have intercourse with a woman on her menstrual period. Now, there are a number of rules that apply to a woman that's on her period. There are a number of rules that things that she can't do. For instance, if she were to sit on a bed, she would make that bed unclean. If she were to lay with a man, she would make that man unclean. And in order to understand this unclean idea, we need to understand exactly what happened at the moment that Adam and Eve sinned. Prior to this moment, Adam and Eve were pure. They hadn't sinned yet. And I don't know this for a fact, but I would tend to believe that Eve never had any periods prior to the sin. Then they brought sin into existence for mankind, and everything changed. And a lot of what changed in a difficult way so that we don't exactly understand it. Even their conscious minds change. Remember this scripture. And as they ate it, suddenly they became aware of their nakedness and were embarrassed. So they strung fig leaves together to cover themselves around the hips. I'll call the worship this morning. And a few lines later, these are probably one of my favorite parts of the Bible, is a few lines after this. It's where they're hiding and God's going around and he's calling them. And of course he knows right where they are. But they're hiding from him because they are embarrassed. And then he finds them and he engages them in a conversation. And he asks this question, "Who told you you were naked?" And it's just like a mother when she's interrogating her little child who she knows is guilty. And it's just exactly the same way. God says, "Who told you you were naked? Did you eat from that tree?" Sure enough, and from then on, it was all downhill for mankind. So I'm going to try to sum this up as easy as I can by simply stating that from that moment on, mankind lived in a state of sin. Now, theologians give a number of reasons why God gave this law about the menstrual period and all that sort of thing. And one of those was to teach a man and a woman self-discipline and a restraint of passion. Another law they came up with is the hygienic benefits of not doing it. And a third thing that they came up with was to teach men and women a high regard for the reproductive organs and respect for the sacredness of blood and life. Now, if you read all of these explanations, they just sound to me like they're coming out of a man's mouth. Whether they're true or not, I have absolutely no idea. Yes, they apply, you know, I don't know. I don't know what God had in mind, but I do know that that's exactly what he said, so hey, we're going to go with it. But it's also interesting to note that there are a number of rules that we'll find out about later on that a woman has to go through in order to cleanse herself two times. One, after she's had a menstrual period, and two, after she's given birth. And what's interesting to note is that even Mary had to do these things, having given birth to our Lord Jesus, who of course we know was sinless. Let's look at Luke and see what he says. "And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses. They brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what the Lord, what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. All in all, it's a very complicated topic to try to figure out exactly why God had this particular law. But we're just going to go with it, and I hope we've shed just a little bit of light on that today. Our 21st law says not to have intercourse with another man's wife. We of course know that as adultery, and here it's spelled out pretty specifically. You will notice, though, that something that's interesting is that nowhere in the law of Moses do you find the word fornication. That's not in the law of Moses, but it is implied later on in the New Testament quite adamantly, but you won't find the word fornication. The next two laws have to do with sex with animals. Now, as distasteful as that sounds, what really bothers me about it is the fact that God felt it necessary to make these laws. But I guess you could say that about this entire category. But anyway, law number 23 is not to have intercourse with a beast. And number 24 is that a woman shall not have intercourse with a beast. So if you're saying to yourself, well, 23 applies to men, 24 applies to women, you'd be exactly right. And this is what the verse that it comes from says. A man must not defile himself by having sex with an animal. And a woman must not offer herself to a male animal to have intercourse with it. This is a perverse act. I love it when God throws in how he feels about these things. Perverse act. We finished this category with the last law, and it too is a pretty interesting law. Number 25 says, not to castrate the male of any species, neither a man, nor a domestic or wild beast, nor fowl. Now, if you just read this, you're not going to understand it, because you actually have to get into Leviticus verse 24 in order to understand what God's talking about here. And that's exactly what we're going to do. If an animal is damaged, has damaged whatever that word is there, or castrated, you may not offer it to the Lord. You must never do this in your own land, and you must not accept such animals from foreigners, and then offer it as a sacrifice to your God. Such animals will not be accepted on your behalf. They are mutilated or defective. So, you need the verse in this particular case to help you to understand that God is actually talking about sacrificial animals, animals that you use for a sacrifice. But that still doesn't completely explain the law, because in the law, and not like this verse, the law includes a man. Most theologians believe that the inclusion of man in this particular law is that God is talking about the Levitical priesthood members who are actually, God doesn't want them to be eunuchs. God doesn't want them to be castrated because they are the ones that are making the sacrifice on your behalf. Whether this is true or not, I absolutely do not know, but it certainly makes sense. Well, that takes care of all of our 25 laws in this particular category. And just like last week we had an interesting category. And I urged you to go home and dig into the chapters, read the chapters that surround these laws, because it's amazingly interesting. You learn so much more than just my telling you about them up here. And it's just totally interesting. Now, the song I picked for you this morning is a song that a lot of times we're coming up into the 21st century with a theology lesson in the song. But in this particular case, I decided to keep it in ancient times with a song that's called Ancient Words by Michael W. Smith. And the lyrics are up here, so feel free to join in and sing right along with them.
words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope in this world where we roam. Ancient words will guide us home. Ancient
Amen. All right, now if you'll turn in your hymnals to our offering and communion song number 149, I Serve a Risen Savior.